McCone and Friends by Marcia Muller. Narrated by Susan Boyce. If you can't take the heat, Sharon McCone. The private investigation business has been glamorized to death by writers and filmmakers, but I can tell you firsthand that more often than not, it's downright tedious. Even though I own a small agency and have three operatives to take on the scut work, I still conduct a fair number of surveillances while twisted into unnatural positions in the front seat of my car or standing in the rain when any fool would go inside. Last month, I leaped at the chance to take on a job with a little more pizzazz, and even then ended up to my neck in mud, quite literally. The job came to me from a contact at a small air charter company, Wide Horizons, located at Oakland Airport's Northfield. I fly in and out of there frequently, both in the passenger's and pilot seat of my friend Hy Ripinsky's Citabria. And when you're around an airport a lot, you get to know people. When Wide Horizons' owner, Gordon Tillis, became nervous about a pair of regular customers, he called me into his office. "Here's the problem," he told me. "For 3 months now, Sam Delaney's been flying what he calls a couple of babes to Calistoga in the Napa Valley. Always on the same day, the last Wednesday of the month. On the flight there, they're tense, clutch at their briefcases, don't talk much. A limo picks them up, they're gone a few hours. And when they come back, it's a whole different story." "How so?" "Well, I heard this from the airport manager up there, and Sam confirms it. They're excited, giddy with relief. Once it was obvious they'd been drinking too much. Another time they had new hairdos and new clothes. They call a lot of attention to themselves." "Sounds to me like a couple of rich women who like to fly, shop, and do some wine tasting and who don't hold their alcohol too well." "It would sound that way to me too, except for two things. The initial nervousness and the fact that they come back flush with cash." "How do you know?" "They pay cash for the charter. And one time I got a look into their briefcases. Even after the plane rental and a big tip for Sam, there was plenty left." The cash did put a different spin on it. "I assume you think they might be carrying some illegal substance." Gordon nodded. "So why don't you tell Sam to search their cases? The FAA gives him the authority to, as pilot in command." Gordon got up and went to the window, opened the blinds and motioned at the field. "You see all those aircraft sitting idle? There are pilots sitting idle, too. Sam doesn't get paid when he doesn't fly. My overhead doesn't get paid while those planes are tied down. In this economy, neither of us can afford to lose paying customers." "Security at the main terminal, X-ray bags." "That's the main terminal people expect it there. If Sam suddenly demands to go through those women's personal effects, the word gets out. People might take their business elsewhere. If he does it in a way that embarrasses them, and face it, Sam's not your most tactful guy, we're opening the door for a lawsuit." "But you also don't want your planes used for illegal purposes." "I see your problem." In the end, Gordon and I worked out a plan, where I would ride in the fourth seat of the Cessna that Sam would fly to Calistoga the next Wednesday. My cover story was that I was a new hire, learning the ropes. I found myself looking forward to the job. It sounded a whole lot more interesting than the stakeout at a deadbeat dad's apartment that I had planned for the evening.
"They're babes, all right," Sam Delaney said, "but I'll let you judge for yourself."
He grunted as he stowed his bag of takeout cartons in the back of the plane. His lunch, he'd informed me earlier. Business had been so bad recently that he couldn't even afford the relatively inexpensive airport dinners. Eating bad takeout food, I thought, probably accounted for the weight Sam had gained in the year or so that I'd known him. He'd always had a round face under his mop of brown curls, but now it resembled a chipmunk's, and his body was growing round to match. Poor guy had probably hired on with Wide Horizons, thinking to build up enough hours for a lucrative job with the airlines. Now he wasn't flying enough to go to a decent restaurant.
"Here they come,"
he whispered to me. "Look at them. They make heads turn, especially when they've had a few pops of that Napa Valley vino."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.